you know, I used to feel like I should like, I wanted to like James Merrill, and Mary today told me I didn't have to. And I don't mind saying that because he's dead. But Black Swan I thought was the most beautiful poem, so I thought I had to understand the other poems, and I really don't. They're too academic for me. They're too hard.
It's a lot of those poems
need that much work.
A lot of them are in trick on white people.
Yeah.
It's like all the white people in all the colleges got together, and they're like, let's just make it hard for people to take English tests and get into college. Let's like, and they came up with like the most abstruse poetry that they could drum up, and that's what they've been tormenting. A lot of what passes is that unintelligible poor Stookie is not, if you actually, I remember there was a time once I was at a poetry reading, there were all these great critics, and Seamus Heaney was there, and James Merrill was there, and Sven Burkert, Helen Bindler at Harvard College, and Robert Polito, and I was asking them, I don't get it. And Merrill had just given this reading. I said, it's a terrible reading. It didn't make any sense.
But Black Swan is an amazing poem.
That's an amazing poem. But the interesting thing was when I said, so help me understand, y'all. Help me understand. What was great about this? And they were like, and they looked off in the distance. Well, you know, it's as if in La Ventura, and they start talking about something else.
Yeah.
And then you realize, oh, this is a trick. Y'all don't like this either. But y'all are going to think that you do, and I'm so upset about that.
Karen Alden is easy to understand. Philip Larkin doesn't take an enormous amount of decoding. There are many poets that don't take an enormous amount
that of decoding. That
is true. I quoted your poem today on the airplane, and you didn't even know what I was talking about. It's like, what's that?
I was like, that's great, who wrote that?
But I can't memorize it as well as you do. I have other. I'm pretty good at memorizing lines.
You're excellent at that. You have other questions, though, Tim. We've gone down a rocky road.
There's a question here from a lady who says, email and texting and the always on with devices, I feel, has impacted us in our letter writing. In a story on your book in the Los Angeles Times, you're quoted as saying your father wrote amazing thank you letters. Can you please talk about those?
He wrote amazing letters, period. And my mother writes amazing letters. My sister writes amazing letters. And I feel like the letters are an incredible gift, and people are so happy to receive a letter. And my son wrote 2 thank you notes this week, and I was so proud of him because they were actual letters. He was proud of them, and he really thought about them. In terms of projects themselves, like, I think I prefer being on stage, first of all, but I like things that are very extreme. I like things that are very, very dark, very, very funny, very, I don't like, you know, nice plays about people who go to the Hamptons and sisters get in a fight and then brothers and parents and girl and like
every film released this year.
if I'm going to do a play, I want to love it a little bit more because it takes so much out of me. But I do love extremes more than most in either direction.
Hey, considering the success you've achieved as an actor and now an author, if you could wake up tomorrow with the same level of experience and accomplishment in a different profession, what might that be?
Please say look. I'm so sorry.
I have a lot of respect for people who take care of the elderly, you know, like pediatric nurses, people like who do those kind of jobs. But those are the people that I really, really admire. And people, you know, that you overlook, like people who deliver your groceries, you know, I feel like those are the people who, that's the only job they can get probably at the time, you know, and they are the one who could be out, you know, keying your car or slicing your tire or whatever, but the people who are taking the jobs, because I've taken those jobs, I've been that person. And a lot of us have. And I don't think about what I don't have in those terms. I think about how, I beat myself up a lot about what, if I feel like I haven't done something well enough. And it's something I'm working on, and it's something I'll probably work on until I die. But in terms of what I can't do or don't have in those terms, I'm just thankful that I can do anything, honestly. I really am. I am.
You have really high standards for yourself, high standards of performance.
Why not? I mean, something can always be better. You know, you can always improve something. No? You don't think so?
No, I have right things 60 times. So, yeah. No.
Right? That's
the same way. Question for Mary Karr, please. Says, I have a fascination with the concept of whether writing can be taught or is it an innate gift. As a creative writing teacher, where do you stand on that?
I mean, I turned down a job at Columbia because I think it's the worst creative writing program in the history of Western civilization.
You're not smart enough to understand that.
For all the people who did not write a book with a collection of letters, who would you like to invite to read their letters around the table?
Oh, Jesus would be good.
Jesus has gotten a lot of mail.
Yeah. He gets a lot of airplay. Jesus and,
That's a great idea. Like to read their
Eleanor Roosevelt?
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you something. Flannery O'Connor with the NLP on the Jesus thing. Thank you guys so much.